first degree was in archaeology, and I always had an interest in archaeology. My archaeology degree was a very heavily science-weighted degree, which is why later on I took other academics in a more pure science role, which I can come to in a minute. However, the archaeology quite clearly did inspire me to learn more traditional skills and techniques that were, at the time, really dying out. Blacksmithing has become a very popular hobby for people over the last 10, 15 years, which, of course, is very good. And the reason for that is probably television. But at the time, blacksmithing was a dying profession, along with a number of other professions were considered dead professions, only because from a metalwork point of view, fabrication in a fabrication shop with welding and machines and laser cutters and water jet cutters was the norm. So through many hobby blacksmiths over the time and many different countries, blacksmithing has survived. However, my interest was more to do with being a traditional skill and being a old time skill. My first introduction to blacksmithing actually was when I took a visit as a child to a heritage center where there was a blacksmith who demonstrated and showed the blacksmithing skills. He was actually the person I trained with later on in life and trained as a blacksmith with this gentleman. He said something quite humorous to me at the time, which was, "Blacksmiths make nice things and farriers make money." Now, I wasn't really interested in making money, but I felt training as a farrier, which is a completely different skill set, would round out my knowledge of blacksmithing and traditional skills that involve metal, because it was in the 1300s that both England and France developed independent farrier professions specializing in horses, horseshoes, whereas blacksmithing continued to act as the manufacturer and the repair center for everything to do with metal. And it was the archaeology that stimulated me to go that way. And I would add also, and I can't remember, and I really can't remember, I watched a television program, and it was a blacksmith that was engaged on a restoration project, and I think that was what tipped the scales for me to go and start studying blacksmithing. I enjoyed the fact that blacksmiths were, at the time, before fabrication shops, the most important person in a community, which is where the connection comes from an archaeology point of view. Obviously, from an archaeology point of view, I moved away from archaeology and went down a much more scientific route, which I can say quite clearly helps me teach blacksmithing. I moved towards PhD in, oddly enough, astrophysics. And it's the knowledge of physics and other aspects of physics and chemistry that helped me teach blacksmithing. That might sound odd because I'm well aware that many people teach blacksmithing and they just use the method of this is what you do, this is how you do it, etc., etc. But I find a lot of the people that attend my workshop, without getting into really technical detail, they enjoy the aspect of the physics behind metal, the temperatures, the spectrum of colors, the whole concept of molecules. And I try not to inundate people on workshops with too much detail But I do find that they enjoy that aspect of it because it makes them understand how the steel will bend, move, and be drawn out. Or, more importantly, how to make it happen easier. Many people start learning the blacksmith profession, skill, technique, trade, hobby. I find it's quite a common trait that the first thing you do is try to hit the metal as hard as possible. If not missing the metal and hitting the anvil, they usually hit the steel and bend it all out of proportion, making awful marks all over it. I have made and done heritage-based products for people in the past, and one of the comments I've had was, well, there's no imperfections in it. And all I could think about was, well, I spent hours and hours trying to not put imperfections in it, and now you want imperfections in it. Of course, when people start blacksmithing as a beginner, they usually have large imperfections in it, and it's the fact that they feel they have to hit the steel hard, and it's more a rhythmic pattern of hitting rather than just bashing on it. And it's often sometimes when I'm explaining to people how the molecules of metal and different heat temperatures work that they then realize that they don't have to just hammer it very, very hard. At the same time, there's another aspect to blacksmithing. Many people watch television and they watch TV programs and they make the assumption that you have to use a hammer to achieve every result. And one of the things I'm doing in the workshop is I allow people to experiment and then afterwards show them the easy way of doing it. And they often are quite surprised that you can achieve many results without using a hammer, which is a revelation for many people because they've watched lots of television programs that all you see, because of course it's a edited television program, what you see is people hammering steel.
How would you say blacksmithing evolved over the centuries?
The main concept of blacksmithing really has been steady and constant for many centuries. If you go to countries around the world where they don't have access to technology and they don't have the financial ability to purchase expensive equipment, you will see in reality traditional blacksmithing done with the bare essentials. And that's an interesting point because one of the concepts of the workshops is I try and keep it as traditional as possible because the whole concept of blacksmithing hasn't really changed. I think the problem being is many people watch television programs and see someone who is conducting blacksmithing, but in reality what they're doing is they're combining blacksmithing with fabrication. You'll see them using welding equipment and you'll see them using power hammers. Though to be fair, power hammers have been around for years, but they use modern equipment. Whereas when I deliver a workshop, because I have this aspect of me looking at traditional skills, I ensure that people in the workshop, they only use traditional skills. I do take a gas-powered forge, but at the same time, I have a coal hand-cranked or hand-blown forge in the workshop, which is exactly what would happen. You would have, in ancient times, they would have a build their forge in hardened clay. They would have holes in it where they could blow air through it. Now, I do run a workshop, which is the medieval blacksmithing, and often what we do is I show them how to make their own charcoal. So they build an under subsurface kiln, and we put wood in it, and we burn it, and then we pull it apart, and by the end of the workshop, they produce their own charcoal. Which is really where I aim for on a workshop. I want people to understand the whole concept of blacksmithing rather than the fabrication shop. By the time people have finished the workshop, they've created three projects, whatever the workshop is, without modern equipment. There's no power tools, there's no power hammer, there is no welding, there's no oxyacetylene. It is all manual manipulation. And that's because I realized that blacksmithing, as a general rule, hasn't changed for centuries. It's only really changed in the last 20 years, where artisans, for a better term, have combined fabrication with blacksmith skills. There's nothing wrong with that, but it is not traditional blacksmithing. And again, you said you wanted to go back to the archaeology. It's because of that that my workshops are delivered in a manner that is very traditional, and you won't see power tools. You won't see anything that you would see on the television programs, which is, again, there is nothing wrong with that, but that's not what I'm trying to put across when I run the workshops. I'm trying to give someone a chance to take part in a very interesting pastime, but do it in a traditional manner. One of the things I say to people in the workshops is, it doesn't mean that when you leave the workshop, you can't use modern equipment. It just means that you now know you can create something which is quite attractive with the basic tools. And I think a lot of people that attend the workshops, they really appreciate that, because they now know that if they want to go and buy expensive equipment for their own personal hobby workshop, that's fine. But they don't need to. They don't have to buy expensive equipment. They can take very basics. They can buy a set of tongs and a hammer and a file and a few little small items along with an anvil and create great things. And that's because the blacksmith profession really hasn't changed for centuries. As I said, you can go to countries around the world where they don't have the financial ability to purchase expensive equipment, and they are repairing and making metal items in a traditional blacksmith sense, or in some cases producing fantastic artwork that you often associate with what you would see on the television when people have a massive workshop full of equipment. And yet those people can create artwork with the very basics, and it's to a certain extent a lot better than some of the things you see. I often see things posted on the internet, people promoting their work, and you can quite clearly see it's not blacksmith, it's fabricated. Again, there's no problem with that, but then don't advertise it as blacksmithing. Blacksmithing is exactly what it is, to strike black metal, hence that's where we get the word from, to smite black metal. Hopefully that explains that.
You are mentioning Damascus steel in your...
Yes.
Can you expand on that, please?
Yeah, Damascus steel is... What people often promote as Damascus steel isn't really Damascus steel. What most people deliver when they produce Damascus steel is actually pattern welded steel. I'm not talking welded as in modern welding. I'm talking about forged welding. Damascus steel, and to be fair, one of the things I actually do is I do deliver pattern welded steel as a course, because it is the basic concept for people to understand. And I only have 3 days on a workshop, so it's very difficult to get somebody to produce something from nothing in 3 days when we're talking about folding steel. And what I actually do from a Damascus steel point of view is technically it is pattern welded steel without the welder, it's forged welding. But it's the easiest way people to understand mixing metals. So what I do for the workshop is I take two different metals, one with a high carbon content, one with a low carbon content, and you put them together and you continually fold them over and over and mix the metals together. So from a forge welding point of view, what you're really doing when you forge weld metal is you turn two pieces of metal, or more than two pieces of metal, a and you make it one piece of metal. So that's to do with the heat. So what you're really doing when you're folding high carbon and low mild carbon steel is you're mixing two metals together and you're forming into a single block, and you fold it and fold it and fold it, and at the same time you're getting the mixture of carbons. The reason for doing that is I'm not into making knives. A lot of people seem to think it's a good idea to make knives. That seems ridiculous to me. There's so many more great items you can make when you start mixing metals. I think, again, people watch television and everyone seems to make knives, which of course is a very silly thing to do. We'll take a knife as an example. It's a very good example. When you start mixing a high carbon content and low carbon content, you have the flexibility of the low carbon steel and you have the hardness of the high carbon. So if you're making a knife, you get a nice flexible blade with a very hard, sharp edge. But the other side of it is you mix in two different carbon content steels, you can then draw the pattern out. So by time on a workshop, you've created a large billet of two steels, you then put a symmetrical pattern into the steel. And again, you hammer that pattern out of it and then make something with it. It's when you finish making it, then you put it into an acid etch of whatever form you wish. And there is different types of etching, and it draws the pattern out, which is really what Damascus steel was in the old ancient world, where they patterned steel and put intricate designs on it. Whereas what a lot of people do today, including myself, because it's an easy way of teaching people, is pattern welded steel. But at the same time, you can draw the pattern out by etching it in a chemical content. I say symmetrical pattern because I've often had people in the workshop that have decided to do something artistic on the steel, but it wasn't symmetrical. And then by time they've drawn the pattern out, the finished product, the pattern was all over the place instead of in a symmetrical manner, because the whole concept of your pattern welded steel or your Damascus intricate designs is to allow the finished product to have a covering across the whole surface of a reasonable symmetrical design, whatever that design might be. And I always allow people to experiment, and what I say by that is, if they want to put a pattern in it that's not symmetrical, I'm not going to stop them doing it, because though it won't final result they're looking for when they finish the product with it, it will teach them to put a symmetrical pattern in. That sounds a little cruel, but people need little reminders when they're learning things. I often find when I teach whatever I'm teaching, if you put little reminders there, may them do them by accident themselves, or you input them yourself, it will help them remember those lessons, may it be practical, may it be academic, may it be theory. And the whole concept of allowing people to experiment is so they can learn. If I was forever correcting people, they would never learn. So therefore, back to Damascus steel, they may put a pattern that isn't symmetrical before they actually make the final product. I know it's not going to turn out well. They'll have a nice product at the end, but the pattern will be symmetrical across the finished product. They're not unhappy. One person took their product and they turned it into a Nordic bracelet. It was beautiful finished when they'd done it, but the pattern was non-symmetrical. But they weren't unhappy, they were very happy with the finished product, but they remember the lesson, which is to put a symmetrical pattern across it while you're actually doing it. Okay, let me rephrase that. Before you start the final product, the billet needs to have the pattern in it, because you put the pattern in it and then you hide the pattern by hammering it back out. It's only through etching that the pattern shines through.
Blacksmithing is very physical, and that might discourage some interested parties who would like to learn blacksmithing, but they feel that they might not have that physical endurance for blacksmithing. How would you advise someone to prepare themselves for a blacksmithing workshop?
I usually don't give advice like that, but if someone asks me, my advice is very simple. If you are a right-handed person, you're going to hold the tongs with your left hand, and it's actually the left arm that will ache more so than the right, because all day long you're gripping tongs. Whereas how I explain to use the hammer, imagine if you were holding a small canary in your hand. If you hold it too loosely, the canary will fly away. If you hold it too tightly, you're not going to do the canary much good at all. And that's how you should hold the hammer. So your arm, from a hammer point of view, is nowhere near used to the same extent as the left, if you're right-handed, because you're constantly gripping tongs all day. Saying that, I don't usually give advice, but if people ask me, I tell them to start buying sets of those exercise grip devices you can buy for improving your grip, because of course you're improving your forearm and your triceps at the same time by doing gripping exercises, because it's the gripping that people will suffer. Again, back to the hammer. I see beginners trying to hit steel far too hard, and they become inaccurate to start with, so they make a mess of steel. But at the same time, you don't need to hit the steel that hard. You need to hit the steel accurately, rhythmically. Oh, and more importantly, back to the spectrum, the right color temperature. Now, I can move cold steel, I can move hot black steel. But obviously, beginners, I need to make sure that the steel's hot enough to move. So I try and get them to not hit black steel. As soon as the color goes out of the metal, because it heats up and goes through the spectrum, to put it back in the forge. Therefore, they're not hitting hard on the steel. They're not banging it hard. They're not exhausting the shoulder and the wrist. But the left hand, for a right-hand person, yes. The grip, your forearm, your wrist, your triceps, your fingers. At the end of the day, they're quite sensitive. But again, it's a gripping exercise. It's not as physical as you think. And yes, a lot of people after day one, they're quite exhausted, but it's definitely not as physical as people think, because I think television doesn't do the profession, the trade, the skill, much justice, because of course television has to be entertaining. And if television's entertaining, then it tends to distort the facts. That makes sense, right? Though I do teach a lot of workshop, I haven't done a lot of work blacksmithing recently, and the reason being is twofold. One, I still write academic papers, and two, I obviously am busy working as a farrier. Though, to be fair, I have in the last few weeks retired from farrier work, which is something I plan doing from January last year. That would hopefully allow me to get back on and do some more artistic blacksmithing, which would be nice. But at the same time, I also have other interests, as you know, which is the sailing. And as I said, I still write academic papers. So the farrier aspect has basically taken up an awful lot of my time. Not that I'm complaining, but it's not allowed me to do any blacksmithing. The workshops have been very good for me, as well as the people that attend, because it allows me to take that break from farrier work, and it allows me to get back to blacksmithing and help people get involved in something that's really interesting, because it's not just about creating something. It's about being involved in a traditional profession that without hobbyists around the world, which is true, without hobbyists around the world, it would not have survived. No matter of the skill level of the hobbyist, it's the hobbyist that's helped it survive. And more importantly, though I'm not overly keen on the television programs that portray blacksmithing, they've actually helped massively because it's made it something that people want to do. Unfortunately, it gives them a distorted picture, but that's not the point. It's about creating something, yes, but it's about a traditional profession. It's about being part of something that's existed all the way back to the Iron Age and before that in the Bronze Age. It's a stunning occupation. It's a stunning hobby, and it's a brilliant art form. And again, I'm not criticizing people that use welding equipment. That's great. I mean, all they're doing is expanding and developing the blacksmithing and artistic metalwork side using different techniques, skills, and equipment. But blacksmithing is about blacksmithing. And I think that's what interests me. And I think I try and put that across in the workshops, but I don't always get a chance because I've been busy working with horse owners for a long time now, which takes up a lot of my time. It's a very interesting profession. I can say quite clearly that Great Britain, France, Denmark, Germany, Northern European countries, highly skilled farriers, highly educated farriers, and very, very much legislated. I'm in Canada, as you well know. I know lots of brilliant, excellent farriers in Southern Ontario, and I know farriers from other parts of Ontario. The problem I find from farrier point of view in Canada, and it's a big issue, is it's not legislated. There is no requirement to be trained, which is horrifying for me. And the reason I'm so busy, and the reason I came to Canada, and I was planning on retiring in Canada many years ago, and I ended up taking on a few farrier clients, and I was planning doing a few blacksmith commissions. Unfortunately, because there's no legislation in Canada and there's no requirement to be trained, there's an awful lot of people out there doing dangerous work, not really understanding how horses should behave, expecting horses to understand English or French, and they don't. So you have to be able to read the horse and read the behavior to do the job correctly. But at the same time, it's not just about that. It's about being able to deliver the right professional level of work. And I find that the level of work, unfortunately, in Canada, specifically Northern Canada, but even in Southern Canada, it's very poor. Now, what I'm saying is I wasn't expecting to be as busy as I was, and I ended up working with, and I think at the height, it's 644 horses on the books, which means every 8 weeks I'm visiting a horse, and I had to get through 644. And it was constant. And one of the reasons I trained a lot of farriers, not just blacksmiths, is because I was so overworked. I was inundated with people with horse-related problems that couldn't be, that veterinary surgeons were unable to work out. Not because veterinary surgeons are incapable, but I see horses all day long, and I have a knowledge and a training in horses. I understand how mechanics of the horse work. Veterinary surgeons, of course, unfortunately, have to deal with all animals and don't get the interaction that I do. So I've had large sums of horse-related clients that vets have tried to help, can help sometimes, can't help. I've had large amounts of horse-related clients that other so-called farriers have wrecked and destroyed horses and it's taken years to either build up the comfort and trust that the horse will let me work on them and get the hooves back to normal. It's a very technical aspect. Having a deep understanding of anatomy and physiology of a horse is imperative, but if you've had no training, how could you possibly understand all the complex skeletal and muscular system of a horse and expect to be able to, one, trim the horse to make it balanced, and then importantly, you're going to put shoes on, and now you're putting sharp metal nails into tissue. And without knowing exactly where to put it, and trust me, people don't know exactly where to put it, you're going to cause so many problems. And that's why I've been so busy. That's why I haven't been on holiday for years. That's why I try and get involved in the blacksmith workshops and run as many as I can, because it gives me a break from that. That's why I try and go sailing on weekends as much as I can, because, of course, I don't have any time. My wife doesn't know who I am. So last January, I decided to completely retire from Farrier work. And it's taken me up until now, and I'm still not quite done. I've got another 2 or 3 months just making sure that I don't walk away clean from a client without making sure they're happy, whoever I've handed them over to, and make sure their horses continue. I'm not doing farrier work at the moment in the normal sense. I'm just supervising and checking on horses and making sure that the clients that I've handed to other people are happy. But I've got another 2 or 3 months of just ensuring that I feel comfortable in myself, that I haven't let anyone down. I certainly have a lot more free time. Hence, we're talking today. Today would have been a much more difficult proposition 12 months ago. Are there many horses where I am? Yes. I mean, I had 644 horses on the books, and that is nothing compared to what is actually around. I mean, I had clients that owned up to 20 horses. I had a client that owned 42 horses at one time, and that's just one client. The average person might have 2 or 3. The location I'm sat at the moment, talking to you, there's, I think, 6 horses here. And there is horses everywhere of many different breeds, many different crossbreeds, and many different environmental conditions. Many of the people that I've trained, I often say to them, if you can work and be efficient in Northern Ontario as a farrier, you can be a farrier anywhere. Of course, the word is be efficient, because the environmental conditions are so drastic at times. Plus also, the damage to hooves that I see allows people to develop good quality farrier analysis skills. I'll give you an example, since you were asking about farrier work. I had a young girl, and she came from Guelph University, and she came and spent just 6 months with me, and I told her quite clearly that she needs to go and find an apprenticeship when she's finished. 6 months isn't really enough. It's enough to get the basics. It's enough to understand the concept, but she needs to go and find an apprenticeship. And her first input into farrier work in Northern Ontario, she couldn't believe the standard conditions. Whereas she'd come from a location in Guelph where the barns were well presented and very posh. Up here, people have them in a field and a small barn or a shelter. So the conditions are very different. But then the other aspect of what I'm getting at with this young girl is she had such an exposure to hoof-related problems that now I had a little chat with her last November, and she was saying that she's got a really nice business because what she's dealing with is a lot of hoof-related problems that other farriers and vets can't solve. That doesn't mean to say they're incapable. It just means they haven't had the exposure. In Northern Ontario, the exposure to environmental problems caused to horses, or farrier problems caused to horses, or owner problems caused to horses, is massive. So this young lady, she had a massive exposure to hoof problems, and now she's got a very, very specialist business in the Guelph area dealing with hoof-related problems that other people can't solve. And it's because of the amount of horses, which was what your question was, that I had so many clients that I've had an opportunity to train many people as farriers over the years, either as apprentices or in some cases 6 to 7 month training courses where they're then advised to find their own apprenticeship when they go back to their own location. And it's because of the large amount of horses in this area that has allowed me to do that, which is nice because, again, there's no legislation in Canada, there's no requirement to be trained. There is voluntary training in Canada and organizations in different provinces that stimulate people to go and train, but it's not a requirement. Therefore, you can come across a variety, a very large variety of farrier skills from 0 to 10. And of course, 0 doesn't help the horse very well. So it's been actually quite a nice pleasure to train people in the farrier world. Not that I was expecting to be so busy myself, but it's been nice training people in the farrier world, because I'm promoting good quality horse care from a farrier point of view. That brings me back to the blacksmith workshops. The blacksmith workshops, because I haven't had a chance to do too much blacksmithing per se myself, have allowed me to escape from the constant farrier work that seems to be 7 days a week, 365 days a year, working from 8 o'clock to 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night. So 8 in the morning till 10 o'clock at night sometimes, or later, even middle of the night visits, which has happened. Yes, so it's been stressful working as a farrier, where the limitation of farriers is poor, the amount of horses is high, and preventing me doing blacksmithing, which may not be a bad thing. Maybe I needed a break from it, and the workshops were a good way of keeping involved with it and teaching people in blacksmithing without feeling I needed to go make something. The connection between farrier and blacksmithing is historic. In the 1300s, Great Britain, or England at the time, and France both independently chose to train horse specialists. Farrier comes from the Latin for ferrum, and if you to look at farrier, a lot of the French Canadians often call it ferrier, from F-E-R, from ferrum for iron, from Latin. And France and England both independently developed in the 1300s a profession, farrier profession in English, to support horse care. So the farrier profession goes all the way back to the 1300s. And it's around the 1300s that the city of London developed trade professions and split farrier and blacksmith up, along with all other professions, including cooper and carpentry maker and all the other hand trade skills. So from the 1300s, blacksmiths never touched horses and farriers did. In some countries, Canada is a very good example. Canada is a very young country from a European point of view, not a young country from an indigenous point of view. But because it's a young European country, a lot of the terminology is interchangeable. Someone will use the word farrier and another person uses the word blacksmith, and they're really referring to somebody who works on horses, when in reality, from a Northern European point of view, a farrier and a blacksmith are completely two different professions. To the extent, if you were to go to a heritage village in England, or probably France, though I've never actually been to one in France, you would find the blacksmith shop and the farrier shop next to each other. Because, of course, when farriers were working full time, we didn't have cars, so therefore we didn't travel to the client. The client came to you with their horse. And it makes sense having the blacksmith shop and the farrier shop next to each other, because the apprentices of both professions could interchange skills and have a general working knowledge of each other's profession. A farrier obviously would make shoes and nails and other required tools for the farrier work, whereas the blacksmith, they would make everything and often would be employed and have apprentices making nails for the farrier. And having an interchangeable skill between apprentices makes sense, but at the same time, they were definitely two separate professions. And again, both the farrier and the blacksmith profession are traditional skills. You can go all the way back to 2000 years and you can see in documented records where people have actually put shoes on horses, either bound on or nailed on. So it's not something, it's a new profession. It's just in the 1300s, it became a separate profession. Whereas prior to that, blacksmiths, as a general rule, would deal with everything, which is why I think in some countries, Canada, United States of America, you find the term is interchangeable. An example would be the World Blacksmith Championships. Now, the World Blacksmith Championships is called that because all countries were invited to attend. But in reality, what it should read is World Farrier Championships, because it's farriers, not blacksmiths. But it's because some countries still use the word blacksmith, so therefore they use that term for the actual competition. And it's a really interesting competition, actually. It would be worth anybody interested in blacksmithing to go and view the World Blacksmith Championships, which you're going to see farriers. But my point is, you see highly skilled people working and making shoes from a farrier point of view. I am well aware that a number of these television programs where they have different blacksmiths making things, some of the more skilled individuals on these television programs are usually farriers, because a farrier worked with making, he deals with making steel items professionally on a daily basis rather than as a hobby. And often when I have a blacksmith workshop, I'll direct people to watch the World Blacksmith Championships, which are all over the internet. Not because I'm trying to convince them to become farriers, because I want them to see that highly skilled professionals who use metal, anvil, forge, hammer, tongs on a professional level rather than a hobby level. And but yes, so there is a distinct difference between the two professions. And it's a historic point of view. It comes from a change in attitudes in the 1300s. Probably gone on too long now.
Working as a farrier and a blacksmith as well, you are working with a lot of heat. That might be okay in winter. How do you work in summer?
Okay, if we were to take the workshops are ran outside. Now, that's not normal, because a blacksmith workshop tends to have to be dark. Traditional blacksmiths, the workshops are dark. And the reason being is back to the color spectrum of steel and heat. Often the blacksmith would need to see the color of steel so he understood exactly how he can manipulate it depending on the task. So a blacksmith's workshop was dark and enclosed. And yes, I have worked inside blacksmith workshops. I trained with a gentleman that ran the heritage workshop when I was the one I visited as a child. And it is very, very hot in there. And yes, you are stripped down to the t-shirt and you lose a lot of fluid and you need to drink a lot. Yes. Even in the winter, in a workshop, you're going to be very hot. I run the workshops outside because I'm dealing with people that are used to working physically often, because I get people from all walks of life. So I work outside. They do lose the advantage of having a darkened workshop to look at the steel. But we're looking at people who are beginners at this stage. They probably don't really understand the different color spectrums anyway with the steels and heats. And I find doing the workshops outside allows people to stay cool more naturally. And in winter, well, from a professional farrier point of view, if I'm working outside, I'm reasonably warm from working full stop. Having the forge running, which is the reason I have a gas forge, of course, has become a farrier point of view. Oh, and it's convenient from a blacksmith point of view if you wanted a gas forge, but it's not really traditional. Obviously, the extra heat in minus 40 is okay, but I find that the farrier working in the summer, I prefer to be outside, not in barns. And from a winter point of view, if it's minus 40, yes, I really need to be inside because the temperature of the tools is pretty uncomfortable in your hands. But generally, as a general rule, you warm up quite quickly working in a farrier in the winter. And in the summer, yes, it's better not to be in barns because the heat of the animals themselves is enough, and then it's stifling. And if you take that to blacksmithing, of course, the same applies. If you are in a tiny little workshop in summer and it's stifling heat outside and you're already heating up, you're going to find yourself very much dehydrated. And the most important aspect of somebody building their own workshop, a blacksmith shop, is they need to really think about not only ventilation for the fumes to be extracted, but ventilation for fresh air to come through and help them not be overwhelmed by the heat. So yeah, it could be a big issue for a hobbyist who's planning to build a workshop. And I think that's the key point here. It's not about me working in a blacksmith workshop or outside, or being working on horses inside or outside. It's really to do with someone who's interested in wanting to take this up as a hobby, an artistic endeavor, and think about the workshop, think about their working environment. There's a number of issues which are from a, I'm going to use the word health and safety, but I'm not talking about ventilation here and airflow. I'm talking about safety with heat and fire. But at the same time, while thinking about positioning a forge so it doesn't burn the workshop down, or set something alight, at the same time, they do need to think about ventilation for their own personal well-being. They need to think about access to water so they don't dehydrate. They need to think about extraction of fumes, may it be from a gas forge, may it be from a coal or a coke forge. You're going to have some form of fumes. One of the things that is an issue, of course, is if you're using coal or coke, you need to think about not breathing too much dust in, because you're going to breathe dust in, which is another reason that I like to teach outside, so people, it's well vented for people and they don't end up covered top to bottom in dust from coal and coke. Because when I run the introduction workshops, obviously there is gas forges on hand, but also there's a couple of coal forges on hand too, so they can experience both. The gas forge is a modern addition, but it takes a little bit of practice to keep a coal forge running, and the only concession is allowing them to have a gas forge so they can at least achieve the projects at the end of the 3 days. But if you're using coal or coke, you are going to be black by the end of the day. So being in an enclosed space, again, is important for someone looking to set up their own workshop or workspace. You need to think about that. If they're going to use coal and coke, they're going to be covered. So we're going to have to think about breathing dust into their system, or not breathing dust into the system in a reality.
Okay. When you're putting the shoes on the hooves, do you need a vet present in case there are any injuries?
No, you don't need a vet present. The Oxford English Dictionary, its definition of a farrier is an individual who can trim, balance, and shod a horse with veterinary precision. In other words, a highly skilled, highly trained farrier should not require a vet. If you do the job correctly, if you know what you're doing, and you have an in-depth understanding of anatomy and physiology, you don't need a vet. In fact, if you need a vet for a standard shoeing job, you probably should change professions.
As a blacksmith, you mentioned doing artistic blacksmithing. So
yeah.
Are you going to do mostly sculptures?
I haven't really decided, now that I'm retired, what type of blacksmithing I'm going to do. The reason I say that is, if I was in England or Northern Europe, I would probably get myself involved in a lot of restoration projects, which are great to do, but also back to that concept of my original interest, archaeology and history and traditional professions. There's many restoration and heritage projects. In Canada, that's not as easy to find. So I've started thinking about what type of projects I'm going to do once I actually walk clear of the farrier work. As I said, I'm not really doing farrier work now, but I'm still overseeing horses with other people. I've migrated to other farriers, etc., people I've trained in some cases. So it's a slow process, I guess, really, to make myself feel that I've done the best for the horse and the client. So I haven't really decided what type of projects to deliver in a blacksmith point of view, but I have put a lot of thought into them. I've been thinking about some very ornate tables and some water features. I was looking at maybe doing a water feature with a different, from a different point of view. I was thinking of maybe doing a water feature using copper rather than steel. So I've put a little thought into it. But I think the key point here is I'm still going through that final phase of retirement. So I think until I actually draw the line, I don't think it's something I'll be able to make a decision on. It could be more what I really want to do. It could be like I decide, oh, I'm going to do so-and-so. So I'll start working on a project because I feel I want to do it. Not because some people might create artwork or projects in any form or medium of art because they feel I want to make money and sell. That's not a bad thing, of course, if you want to make money as an artist. In my case, I really don't need to make money as an artist. So I think maybe some of the projects I start putting together will be more of interest. Maybe experimenting with techniques that I haven't really used before. One of the tables I was looking at doing was going to be a completely jointed table, but with mixed media. So I was going to joint all of the base together and then take another media and put some artwork on that media, and that media would be either wood or stone, and make the surface of the table wood or stone, and either carve or engrave into the surface. So that would be experimentation for me. I mean, yes, again, back to my academic side, the art side of me is, I think, sometimes my escape from the academics. And experimentation in art, after creating the base of a table and using a different media, I think would be quite interesting. I haven't really decided, but as I said, that's because I'm still stepping from this world to my full retirement, as in not working 24 hours a day.
So you will be doing both functional and non-functional objects?
I think so, because I think if you're looking from the word art, a functional object can be art in itself. whereas a non-functional object is purely art and pleasing to the eye. If you were to take a water feature in a garden pond, that's functional, but at the same time, it's very pleasing to the eye. When you take a table, it's very functional and it can be very plain, but at the same time, it can still be attractive to the eye. If you look at some of the high-level carpentry, carving, woodwork tables from a few hundred years ago, there was art in that. They didn't just turn out a table that was functional. There was art. And there's no reason why a table with metal and other media can't be attractive to the eye as well as being a functional item. Of course, I think the problem being is when you make something that is pleasing to the eye, even if it's functional, you tend not to want to use it because it's too nice to the eye. Okay.
Your materials and also your equipment,
yes.
How do you collect it, or do you make your own, some of your own tools?
The answer to that is very simple. I can make tools and I do run a tool making course. However, not to harp on about how busy I've been as a farrier, I have not had the time to make tools. So for expedience and simplicity, I simply buy tools. I wouldn't have the time to make tools. That doesn't mean to say in the future I wouldn't have time to make tools, because I'm supposed to be retiring. And I do run a tool making course and teach people how to make their own tools, because you're quite right. As a blacksmith, you have to make your own tools, meaning traditionally, you didn't just go to the local supply store and say, oh, I'd like a couple of hammers, and I'd like some tongs, and I'd like X and Y and Z. You had to make those. So one of the workshops I run is a tool making course, and it teaches people the basics of making their own tools. So in my case, I buy tools because I'm busy. But yes, I can make tools if I require it.
You're also painting, and I'm assuming you've been painting for a very long time. What are you painting? Nature, sailing events? What are you painting?
I'm drawn to nature. I like butterflies. I like birds. I like nature. I think if you were to look around outside, the inspiration to draw or paint or whatever you feel you wish to do is there. I mean, even if you take blacksmithing or carving or any form of artwork, I'm not suggesting the only inspiration is nature. But in reality, if anyone is considering themselves artistic in any form, nature is probably one of the best to produce artwork of any form.
About sailing, you mentioned that you're going...
Yeah.
During the weekends, where do you go sailing?
At the moment, I have a small 26-foot sailboat, and I'm in Northern Ontario, and it has a lot of large lakes. My intention is to place a larger sailboat on the east coast of Canada, and therefore I can go sailing for longer periods of time and take trips out into the ocean and enjoy sailing from a travel point of view. I am supposed to be retired, or retiring, of course. I think that's the point. I bought the sailboat so I could enjoy time off, and I haven't really had as much opportunity as I would like. And I've always liked sailing since a child. But my intention, of course, is to put a much bigger sailboat in the ocean and then take longer trips, which gives me those holidays that I haven't really had while I've been working as a farrier. But from a local point of view, there's many large lakes in Northern Ontario that's easy enough to put your sailboat in and go sailing.
Are you going to offer workshops this year?
Yes. Your connection to me was through Matthew. Because I'm very busy and Matthew's a very good organizer, Matthew is trying to develop a heritage center come farm. And I always allowed Matthew to do all of the organizing, and I just turned up with tools and equipment and steel and delivered the workshops. I've enjoyed doing that. And yes, now that I'm moving towards retirement, yes, I'm going to run the workshops. At the same time, I don't believe I'll run any more than I normally run. I try and book, say, six a year, different types, different levels. Damascus steel, for example, or tool making, or organic form and leaf making. Always run the basic one, because some people may come from another workshop that I've delivered, or another workshop that I've attended that someone else has delivered, and don't really need the basic knowledge, so they can attend one of the other workshops. But if you've never really attended a workshop that anyone has ever delivered, the basic workshop teaches you the concept of not hitting the steel too hard, how to bend the steel, how to make circles, how to draw the steel, how to shape the steel, how to form the steel. And there's a whole range of skills involved in the basic workshop that if you were to attend tool making or the medieval workshop or the large project workshop or whatever the ones I'm delivering, I'm not quite sure which ones I'm delivering this year, whatever they are, you would struggle very much. You would have a hard time progressing. And in fact, I have had people that felt that they could attend a more advanced workshop because they've attended a workshop somewhere else, and they got on the advanced workshop and they struggled. Now, that doesn't mean to say they hadn't attended the workshop somewhere else. It just meant that either they struggled learning the skills on the workshop somewhere else, or potentially the basic skills weren't taught, and when they did get to the advanced workshop, may it be the medieval workshop, which is a very advanced workshop, they struggled, and there was an awful lot of help required. Now, lucky enough, because the workshops are usually attended by people that have been on my workshops before, I can get the other people in the workshop to help each of them pair people off. Otherwise, I'd spend an awful lot of time correcting people on day three so I could at least walk away with a project. So I do encourage people to do the basic one, and that's always a workshop that's delivered. This year, I think probably medieval. This will be the third year I've ran that one, and it's a very popular course workshop. Damascus steel I've run a couple of times. That's popular, but it's a very hard course. I think the problem being is when people see Damascus steel, pattern welded steel, they see it on a television program where they're using a power hammer so they can turn a billet into the steel into a billet quite quickly. Whereas on the workshop they deliver, it's all manual and large hammers, and it's tough, and it is a hard course. It's a very physical course. The Damascus steel is very physical. So I don't run it often, because I really want to make sure people attend that have had a little bit of experience, not just a workshop I've delivered. They've done the workshop, and then they've gone away and practiced. They've gone away and got involved in other workshops, maybe, or got a friend, and they've got their own personal workspace together. It's a tough course, so I tend not to run that as often. But the medieval one's popular. The tool making one, I think I'm going to run this year. I haven't decided, but almost certainly tool making, medieval, basic workshop, and then there'll probably be at least two or three more that I will deliver. So I usually aim for five or six a year.
Those who would like to register in these courses, how can they do that?
Matthew will do all of the bookings. He will talk to people. He will help them decide what they need to do and then book the course. Matthew is a funny person in the sense he attended my first ever workshop I delivered at his farm. And I say it's funny because if you talk to Matthew, he will tell you the same thing. He attended on the Friday, the Saturday, and the Sunday. I turned up on the Saturday morning, and he said, oh, I've managed to pick up an anvil, and I picked up some tools. Before the workshop was over, he'd been around some of the other farms and found anvils that had been laying around farms and tools, and he bought them off them. So Matthew, before the second day had started, he'd already equipped himself with blacksmith equipment. And he's attended a number of my workshops, and he actually makes small items. He finds making the small items much easier. And he then sells his small items at the farmer's market. So Matthew doesn't want to be an artistic blacksmith, but what he does like, he likes the concept of traditional skills. One of Matthew's interests is the same as mine. It's traditional skills, and blacksmithing just happens to be one of them. And he likes to produce small utility style hooks or items for the farm or door handles or drawer handles or cupboard handles, whatever. And he then sells those, but not in a professional manner. He goes to the farmer's market to sell his farm produce. He just happens to sell small blacksmith items. So Matthew's a very good example of somebody who actually has attended a course, but at the same time, he helps with all the arranging and the administration and the booking and the hosting of the course. I'm lucky in that sense because I just need to physically arrive and then deliver. But from a booking point of view, yes, what you need to do is obtain the details. And then, of course, when you do your final editing, you can provide that as a booking option. More importantly, because I am retiring, my current phone number in the next 2 or 3 months will be cancelled. So there's no point giving you a phone number that you could advertise me through, because that is my Farrier phone number to a certain extent. And more importantly, when I'm retired, it's disappearing. Anybody that needs to get me, that I'm willing to allow to contact me from a Farrier point of view, will have other means, but my general phone number will be gone. Otherwise, that retirement just wouldn't happen because I'd have people phoning all the time. So Matthew's your best option. And he does advertise. He advertises the workshops on I think he's actually posting this week or next week some of the courses. And then he pushes them and pushes them to get six people. Six people, maximum is a norm. If I have assistants, and sometimes I take helpers, I'm willing to have eight people, but only if I've got extra pair of hands for safety reasons. Usually four people as a minimum, six people as a maximum, eight as a total maximum with additional safety hands, that's all. So. I particularly take a book to the workshop because there's a section in that book that I say, if you buy this book, please ignore this chapter. Because it's a book on blacksmithing, but this particular chapter, and it's headed how to make extra money by shoeing horses. So what it's inferring is you can learn to be a blacksmith making artistic things and now go nail shoes on a horse. And I often take that book to the workshops to point out, ignore this chapter, please, and then go into detail of why you can't just put shoes on a horse. So there is some very good books in the market. So I think that's probably the best thing to do is to send you books that I think would be of interest. In fact, what I'll do is I have no idea if the person who taught me is still teaching or has retired. I think he might be retired. But if he's still operating, I can send you the details of him, so you can see who I trained with as a blacksmith. He's probably retired, so I can't promise anything. I mean, yeah, sorry, you're going to speak.
I will also need some pictures because there are no images on your site. So when you're...
No, I really need to redevelop that website because it sort of talks more about Farrier work. and therefore lies your problem. I tend to be taking the website apart, and it did. I was unaware that the contact form wasn't working, but apparently they'd done some kind of server update and that messed that up. But yes, the whole concept of the website is it's going to be brought down, and then I'll get someone, unless I have my own time myself, I'll get someone to rebuild it and design it more as a blacksmith site delivering workshop style information and some other things like that. I like running the workshops because I think possibly I like teaching, but I find that many people often ask me why I am not teaching in a university, and the answer is very simple. I would think I would find university teaching and lecturing in the university quite stifling, because people are quite shocked when they find out my background. But the blacksmith workshops that I teach, I enjoy teaching. I enjoy teaching people to be farriers. I enjoy teaching. I just think that the rigid structure of a formal academic institute would be too stifling for me. And I think my teaching expression is much better fed and for the benefit of others when I'm teaching workshops and teaching in a more informal manner. Even though the blacksmithing is a very practical aspect, there's a lot of theory goes into it when I teach. And the farrier aspect, when I'm teaching that, yes, it's a practical profession, but as already pointed out, it's a very in-depth theory profession, all the way back down to horse ailments through to anatomy and physiology. So there's a lot of theory I teach. I find that I'm able to put that across to people, very complex problems and subjects, and make them understand it very simply. That doesn't make me clever or a genius. It just means that maybe I understand how people learn, which brings me back to when clients ask me, why aren't you teaching? I think because I wouldn't have that free form of teaching ability in a structured institute. I wouldn't be able to do that. So it's not only hands-on, but even the theory and the actual the knowledge that I impart to people, I'm able to do it in a manner that's not allowed, not available, not possible in a structured institute. The whole concept of teaching theory, if you were to sit there all day and just spiel theory, you'd be asleep in 5 minutes. I mean, one of my favorite things to teach outside of blacksmithing is, well, outside of blacksmithing is not actually strictly true, but it is part of the blacksmith aspect, is things like gravitational theory and the spectrum and other such items like that. I enjoy teaching that. And I think that, I said, outside of blacksmithing, because under normal workshop conditions, people wouldn't probably teach that. But I do, I bring it in. And therefore, it's not that I'm trying to teach them physics. I'm helping them understand something that they're doing with their hands practically and teaching them the theory. And in the same sense, if I was trying to teach the theory to someone from a physics point of view, I would pick practical things that make sense. And I think it's that I enjoy about the teaching more than anything. It's the ability to allow people to learn in a more flexible, informal manner. Hence, when people always ask me, why aren't you at university teaching? Because I don't think I would cope very well. I'll tell you something that inspires me, and you can pick what you want, but this inspires me because, again, I can't deny that archaeology is a fantastic profession, but because I had a very science-heavy based archaeology degree, I went off and did something that is quite, would appear to start with to be completely opposite the scales, which is astrophysics, but it's not. I often talk to people about the pale blue dot. The pale blue dot is a picture of Earth as it happens. And Carl Sagan, he worked for NASA, and he suggested that the Voyager 1, which was one of the probes that left Earth in 1977, when it gets to the outer realms of the solar system, it turns and it takes a last picture of home. And they took a picture of the pale blue dot, and it basically was a tiny little pixel because it was 6.4 billion kilometers from Earth. And he has a very long speech about this, but its opening lines are, this is here, this is home, this is us. And I'm telling you that for a reason, because Carl Sagan, he's dead now. Carl Sagan was an inspiration to many people in the astrophysics world. I would encourage you to look up Carl Sagan pale blue dot and listen to what he has to say, and then go and find an image of the pale blue dot, which is a NASA picture, on, just type image pale blue dot in Google and you'll find it. Because not only is Carl Sagan an inspiration to many other people who is astrophysicists and scientists, but also to many other people, particularly when you listen to what he has to say. I'm getting to my point in a minute. He also created a program called Cosmos. Cosmos has a brilliant, not the Neil deGrasse Tyson newer version, because Neil deGrasse Tyson is doing a Cosmos too. I'm talking about the Carl Sagan Cosmos. The reason I mentioned the pale blue dot, again, it puts everything in perspective. Art is a personal form of expression. And I like the pale blue dot, I like Carl Sagan, I like the cosmos, because of course it puts everything in perspective. It means all of the small problems in life are not that important. But it's interesting because art is important, because art is what inspires other people. Now, you could say the pale blue dot is art because it's a photograph, and photography is a fantastic subject. I'm not particularly talking about digital photography per se. I'm talking originally with a camera and the light and the emulsified lens on the film. So you could say that the photograph is art, but the pale blue dot puts life and the world in perspective. It makes small things insignificant. But art is significant. Look at the great masters. Look at the painters. Look at the carvers. Look at Michelangelo. What did he say? I didn't create it. It was already there. I just removed the debris off it, and that was what the statue came out like. So art's self-expression, and that is important. And again, you're doing a program on arts and different types of arts. So therefore, things that inspire people are artistic subjects. And though the cosmos inspires me, though the pale blue dot, though Carl Sagan inspires me, in reality, what he's doing is, I mean, I take a lot of astronomical photographs, and I have some stunning pictures of the cosmos. That's an art form. I would advise you definitely to look up the pale blue dot, and definitely look up Carl Sagan, pale blue dot, and look at his video when he talks about the pale blue dot. It puts us as a species into perspective. Even though he's talking about science, he's still talking about an art form.
You are leaving a great, really, heritage. You are maintaining, yes, heritage, legacy. You are leaving legacy.
Absolutely. And that was the original attraction. And of course, that's what Matthew's attraction is with his farm. Hence, it's the heritage farm. I mean, Matthew does yurt building. Part of his, one of the courses he runs himself, he teaches people yurt building. That technically is an art form, but in reality, to him, he's teaching a traditional profession that will be forgotten unless you live in Mongolia. And of course, we don't live in Mongolia, right? So yeah, that's Matthew's inspiration too. And I think that's why Matthew and I get on very well, because we both come from the same point of view. We're trying to preserve traditional professions before they're forgotten. I'm lucky in the sense that the television has helped promote that. But as I said, my main issue with television is, unfortunately, often gives you a distorted picture. And then I'll get people coming on the workshops, and then suddenly they find it's not quite what they thought, because it's not what they saw on the telly. But, you know, either way, I agree. That is my inspiration, to teach people the blacksmith thing. I think subconsciously, I think I enjoy teaching because that's why I've taught farriers as well. It doesn't mean I'm good at it. I don't know if I'm good at it. But I think when people walk off the blacksmith courses, and I think they walk away with at least two, supposed to be three, but at least two, because especially if it's a beginner's one, usually wreck the first project. They walk away with two projects, say, at the end of 3 days, and it's a brand new skill of techniques, developing into a skill that they've learned. The faces on those people, you can see they're so happy. Okay, it's something basic and it's simple, but they created that with the hands. They didn't go to a workshop with power tools and a welder and a power hammer and a saw to cut it. They were like, everything was done by hand. And the pleasure you see on their faces when they can walk away and they've achieved something, I think that's the best part to the workshop. I think watching people trying to develop into their own personal artistic self is possibly the nicest thing I see. I think what I like about teaching the farrier thing, which is, yeah, again, it's a traditional old profession, and is it not? It's an art form in itself, is providing this country with skilled farriers that won't harm horses, so horses get the best care possible. And I think that, though it's an art form in itself, and it really is an art form in itself, it's a highly skilled profession. And I think the benefit I see from that is producing people that can do the job. The blacksmithing is slightly simple, different. I'm helping to promote a heritage profession, as you say, heritage hobby, activity, skill, but it's a pleasure to see on the faces. When I see people walk away and they're cherishing the things made and they put them in the car, I'll show my wife this, or I'll show my husband this, and because it's the mixture of men and women on the course is about 50-50. I think it's quite nice to see that. They're looking forward to taking these things home and putting them in the house. Something as simple as a wine bottle holder, just to hold a bottle of wine on the side. They want to take it home and put it on the side. We'll go to the store and they'll buy a bottle of wine so they can take it home and put the bottle of wine in the wine bottle holder, just so, see, it's a wine bottle holder, and they want to put it on the side. And I think that's quite inspirational for somebody who's taught from a complete beginner to turn something out. And I think that's nice. But it's their pleasure on the faces. It's more pleasurable to me.